very thick peptidoglycan layer, which is a very distinguishing feature of the gram-positive organisms. And then you see it has several components there, like you have the cell wall protein, you have the tychoic acids, you have polysaccharides, you have the extracellular DNA. So we wanted to precisely identify which of these components is actually taking a part in the inducing the hydrophobicity. So we did some various enzymatic treatments to selectively dissolve either of these components. So the results are shown here with respect to what we got. This is with respect to flotation of sphalerite and galena. You can see here that the same cells or the extracellular proteins are able to float sphalerite better than galena. So the flotation recoveries are about 70-75% for sphalerite. On the other hand, it is below 20-15% for galena. So when you do the isolation of the protein from the metabolite, you can see that in the absence of the purification protocol, the quantity of the protein that has to be added is about 60 milligrams. Whereas once you identify the protein component and purify it, you can actually reduce the quantity that is required and you will get much better recoveries. The bottom table is basically with respect to the selectivity of separation that is quantified in terms of the selectivity index. So what you see is almost a ninefold increase in the selectivity index after you use the purified proteins. Now, if you want to identify the proteins, you have to actually separate them on a column. So we have developed a protocol where we have a mineral-based column, and what you see here is the purified proteins. You can see that the bands for the first two lanes are the purified proteins. You can see there is an enrichment of the 14 kilodalton and 46 kilodalton protein fractions. The third column is actually the marker, that is the standard protein that is taken. And the last one is your unpurified proteins. So you can see there are several bands there. And then once you purify it, you enrich the fractions of interest. And in other words, you can actually develop a bioreagent by this process. So what you have to do for a protein structure identification is actually an N-terminal sequencing by the Edmund degradation process. The other end is the carboxyl end. You know that the protein molecules are amphipathic, that is, they have the amino groups as well as the carboxyl groups. So you can actually find out the internal peptides by tandem mass spectrometry. You can do the N-terminal sequence by the Edmund degradation. Based on these results, you try to reconstruct your protein. What you see here is a group of amino acids, alanine, glycine, leucine, etc. And you actually build up the protein profile or the sequence. So we have actually deposited the sequence in the protein profile repository. And I talked about the role of the individual components. Here are the results for the various enzymatic treatment. The lysozyme treatment basically selectively dissolves the polysaccharides. You can see that for the results for both the sphalerite and galena, you can see that after treatment there is a decrease in the flotation recovery, but not very significant. But when you talk of the proteinase, that means that selectively dissolves the protein, again you see a marginal decrease in the flotation recoveries. The tychoic acids, there is no enzyme, so we actually purified, isolated the tychoic acid from the extracellular components and wanted to see whether that in itself can float, but that is not able to do that. But what is interesting to see is the DNA. We treated it with DNase, so selectively the DNA is actually chewed up, and then you find there is a significant decrease in the flotation recovery, thereby showing that it is the DNA component which is actually playing a primary role in the inducing the hydrophobicity for flotation to be affected. So we have done a lot of protocols in terms of the thermal recoveries are obtained, that is 11.7 selectivity index, about 90% recovery of sphalerite in the presence of the soluble component of the thermalized cells. So you can see that you will be able to concentrate the component of interest by these protocols, and you will be able to get enhanced selectivity. So just to summarize, you know that the DNA molecule is actually a a double-stranded helix. You have the various components in terms of the bases. You have the hydrophilic and the hydrophobic part. Now, once you do a thermolysis treatment, a double-stranded DNA is actually made into single-stranded DNA. That's what I've shown here diagrammatically. And then you can use the single-stranded DNA more efficiently for the flotation process. As you can see on the top right-hand side, you will see that the flotation recoveries with the single-stranded DNA, that is the green bar, compared to the untreated bacterial cells, if you treat it with the DNAs, you find that the flotation recoveries are decreased, again indicating that DNA is playing a vital part to induce the hydrophobicity. Now, we have done the sequencing again for the DNA, and this is a very involved protocol, so we took the help of the microbiology department in getting this profile. Another important mechanism that the microorganism adopts to resist the toxicity is to have some shape changes or morphological changes, and this is very clearly established here. So as I talked about, these organisms we studied are the bacillus, that is the rod shaped. So in order to counter the toxicity of lead, the bacteria changes its shape from, the bacterial cells change its shape from rod shape to a spear. And you can identify the quantum of this shape change by looking at the MRB expression levels. That is what is plotted here. Now the top one is actually for the Galena adapted strains. That means we grew the microorganisms in presence of lead, that is lead sulfide, Galena. And you can see the expression levels as a function of the adaptation cycle. The bottom one, up to 10 cycles we have done the adaptation, you find that it proportionately decreases. That means the bacteria is changing its shape from rod or rod shape to a spear in the case of Galena. At the bottom, what you find is, that is for sphalerite, there is no change in the expression levels of the MREB sequence. So you are able to clearly say that in this case it was the Bacillus megaterium. It adopts a strategy to overcome the toxicity of the lead. It does not allow the intracellular uptake of lead by changing its shape from rod to spear. I have just given you a flavor of some of the work that we have been doing in terms of leaching, in terms of remediation, and in terms of surface modification. So I would like to conclude my talk by acknowledging the industrial sponsors, the Hattie Gold Mines Company, the Institute of Research and Development France for support of research projects, at the CEFIPRA, the Indo-French Center for Advanced Research. I also had an Indo-UK-UKD project for the bioremediation, and of course the work is all done not by me, but the graduate masters and PhD students to whom I express my gratitude. So thank you all for your kind attention, for inviting me to deliver this 24th lecture. Thank you very much. Teaching has sort of matured with respect to copper, with respect to uranium, with respect to zinc, and also gold. Actually, Australia, South Africa, to some extent copper in the United States have all commercialized plants, and very recently China has put up a bioreactor plant for gold processing. Now the efforts in India, although we had a collaboration with the Hindustan Copper, the Balanchkand copper deposit, they also put up some columns at the site, but they are yet to start on the dump leaching process. The story with respect to the Hattie Gold Mines is they have actually got the bioreactor installed in their plant, but at the moment they are actually processing only the free milling type of gold ores, where mostly gold is present in quartz. Now the other aspect of you can say the surface modification, what I talked about, a lot of lab work has been done, not only in India but also a group in the United States. But as we know, the commercial reagents, like for example the workhorse for flotation of all the sulfides is the xanthate collectors. They have been in use for over 100 years and they are functioning so well that the industry is yet to change. But with respect to the depressants like chromates, then you have the cyanides. There is a strong alternative strategies are being worked out, and in that context the promise is that the bioreagents that I talked about, although all the studies that we have carried out are on the laboratory scale, the important thing would be to actually develop these bioreagents. And then we have shown the potential of these bioreagents. You don't really have to use the bacteria in an actual application. You can actually do the culturing of the organisms, you can isolate the component of interest by using the protocols that we have seen. And once the DNA is isolated, which can be done as a pharmaceutical industry, we can take a leaf out of the pharmaceutical industry, what they are doing. And if we have the shelf life of these organisms, of these reagents is good, we'll be able to market it. So just like the organic synthesis routes have paved the way for development of various collectors, the biotechnology route can be followed for these type of organisms. What is important is they are non-pathogenic organisms. Actually, they are naturally present in the soils, in the waters, etc. They are not toxic. So one can develop the reagent from the liquid. One can, if you do the lyophilization, you will be able to get the solid. You can look at the shelf life and then use it potentially as a reagent. So if it is taken to that level, I think it will have a lot of commercial application. But the question that is always asked is it still a laboratory curiosity? Maybe I have to agree with you at this point of time. And remediation is one thing where I feel that the technologies are a little more available. One can make a membrane like what is done with the polymers. You can have a support for the microorganisms. And what is interesting is they don't have to be live organisms. The biosorption process works equally well for dead biomass because of the functional groups which are actually coming into play. So that is something which can be easily scaled up and put to commercial exploitation.
Containing sulfur can be reduced by the PSR and then metal sulfides are precipitated. Precipitation, is it dependent on the solubility product or the valence of the metal ion or both? And you also said the particles are of nano size. In fact, I would consider it not to have nano size unless you have for marketing. Otherwise, removal of that again from the medium is again cumbersome process. So that is one question. The second one is about surface modifications. How long the surface modification will be retained? If it is a slow one, retaining for smaller period and slowly the adsorbed stress is released, then can this be used for pharmaceutical drug delivery system?
Right. As we all know that when you talk of the group 2 metals, we use the Kipps apparatus to produce H2S and then you precipitate it. So compared to the hydroxide route, that means if you are precipitating the metal as a hydroxide, the hydroxide precipitates are very much colloidal. They are also loose network. Compared to the hydroxide, the sulfide precipitates are very dense. And if you look at the solubility product of hydroxide and in relation to the sulfides are much lower solubility. So you will be able to, we are talking of effluents and concentrations of the order of ppm levels, where you traditional techniques may not be very good. Like, you have other limitations with respect to recovery from dilute solutions. So here what is done is instead of producing a secondary sludge which may be having a problem of dispersal, you are using the sulfides. And if you talk of zinc sulfide or cadmium sulfide, they are also semiconductor materials. So you have some applications in because of their semiconductor properties, you can use them for other applications. So the dense nature of the sulfide precipitate is actually a bonus in the sense compared to the hydroxides. Now, I talked about the the nanosized range. When we precipitate from solution, generally you will find that those precipitates are actually much finer, or particle size is much smaller compared to a milling process. Compared to a milling process, you know, you start from a large size and then you do the reduction. The solution routes, what is called as the bottom-up approach, is always beneficial in terms of nano-sized particles which you get for a precipitation process. The filtration, those aspects are another issues which will come when you try to do the scale-up. Like we know the classic example of the bauxite, aluminium hydroxide, aluminate. So what you do is, you know, the technologies with respect to seeding the precipitate or adding a binder or a flocculant, which is mostly organic. And you know, if you are going to do the drying process, then they can easily be volatilized. So you have some strategies to do the precipitation or the filtration. So of course, the potential is only to indicate that the sulfide precipitate is more denser compared to the hydroxide precipitate. So in that sense, it has got some benefit. And as I told you, the solubility products are much smaller. The role of that in drug delivery systems will actually depend on what are the particles that are used in drug delivery. I mean, we have so many nanomaterials that are used, and I am not sure whether the sulfides are used in drug delivery systems, because right now they are looking at very inert systems, and these heavy metals are not really a good candidate for drug delivery processes. So the second question was with respect to surface modification. See, the bacterial interaction, that is the adsorption process, is very rapid. And you will be very surprised that within the first 15 minutes or 10 minutes, the uptake is quite good. We have done a lot of kinetic studies on the attachment of these organisms onto the substrate. That is, basically we have generated a lot of adsorption isotherms. The kinetics is quite rapid. But if you look at the final delivery mechanism that I am talking about in terms of developing a reagent as a substitute to the conventional organic collectors, then all you have to do is that, you know, it should be soluble in an aqueous medium. That means you are able to prepare a concentration of a desired concentration which you can add. So it's going to be a reagent which is water soluble, which can be directly used for application like a organic synthetic collector. So I think that is not an issue. The only issue is the degradation, those type of things, in terms of, as I talked about, the shelf life. So that has to be assessed. We have not done that. But this thing is very rapid. Actually, the what is called as the conditioning time in flotation, even in this case, is pretty fast. It's just about 5 minutes. And considering the flotation time of even about 15-20 minutes, the first five minutes, the collector is able to readily absorb onto the surface. Right.
I also heard that it contains a very small amount of gold. Maybe 1 part per million or 2 part per million. This your biotechnology, this one will it help to recover those? Is it economically possible?
Right. With the kg of gold tailings that have been accumulated, and if you look at the tenor of the gold that was processed during the, say, the British time, when John Taylor was running the company, we had gold deposits as high as even close to 15 to 16 grams per ton. Today, commercially, the Hatti gold mines, and even when the Bharat gold mines KGF was shut down, they were operating at 4 to 5 grams per ton. So you can see that in terms of the tailings, even about 3 to 4 grams per ton or 2 to 3 grams per ton is still quite a valuable resource. As far as the KGF deposit is concerned, it is again a free milling deposit. That means it is actually gold was initially present in the quartz. So all that was done, if you had recalled your BE time when you went to there, was actually only a stamping mill and a hammer mill just to reduce the size, and then they were using the blankets. Or now today we are using cyanidation. We use the activated carbon process. We try to recover the gold. To my knowledge, that problem of scaling it up was something to do with the dump leaching or heap leaching process. See, when you have tailings in powder form and you want to do the leaching on site, then you have to look at the diffusion of the cyanide through the bed or the dump. So what they did is they tried to agglomerate it by making something like your clinkers, by mixing it with cement, and then they made a pad, and then there is a separate heap leaching cyanidation plant in KGF. This was an interest, about almost 15-20 years back when they were still not closed. But today, if you go there is a separate place, there is a shed there earmarked for the heap leaching, but they are not continuing the process. And there is an interest from overseas people. They say that we can recover the from that deposit, because it doesn't require a bacterial leaching process. I mean, there's no sulfide there. It is easy to recover with the cyanide. And it should be possible with the only limitation are with respect to the forming the something like, if you are doing a pelletization of the gold tailings, and then you do a cyanidation leach to extract the gold.
Sir, what exactly is the difference between the hydrogen sulfide produced by Gibbs apparatus and those produced by nano solution that what you are getting? Is it a very stable or is there any precipitation?
No, the nano thing I talked about is the corresponding sulfides, that is the zinc sulfide and cadmium sulfide. So if you ask me what's the difference, the characterization that we did was something to do with the XRD. So we found that if you talk of sphalerite, that means you produce the zinc sulfide by precipitation using zinc. You start with zinc sulfate and add H2S to precipitate. The zinc sulfide which is formed is actually having a crystal structure similar to that of sphalerite. So in this case, there are other reduced sulfur compounds which are also formed there. That means non-stoichiometric sulfides are also there. It was actually not only zinc sulfide, but zinc deficient sulfides. We had various, something like a mixture of products that we got. So the deeper characterization we did not go, except the particle size. Then there was a difference in the particle size with respect to the zinc sulfide from Gibbs apparatus. And this was much finer. The other one was with respect to crystal structure. Then there was, there is another sulfur compound which is called as the marmatite, which is actually some zinc iron sulfide. So we could actually detect marmatite also in our system. So more than that we did not do, because initially it was only a question of developing a process for treatment of the acid mine water. But as a side issue, I just mentioned that these precipitates can be looked into a little more detail in terms of their semiconductant properties, etc., which we have not done. Once you have any doubts, the research scholars.
Sir, how do you deal with these microorganisms?
How do we deal with the microorganisms?
Sulfide deposits. So they are, you can say, that part of nature. In the context of leaching organisms, that is bioleaching process, what you do is you grow these organisms in a bioreactor if you are doing a bioreactor leaching. So the leaching in a heap or a dump, you don't have to do anything, because that will be part of the dump. If you are talking of the remediation process, where you are using the microorganisms as a film to actually capture the metals, then the substrate that you are using, that is the polymer substrate or inert substrate that you are using, that you may have to regenerate that substrate, because the bacteria may get loaded with the metals, and then there is a process of desorption using mild acids. So you can recover your metal using mild acids. We have seen that you can reuse the film for several cycles. And as I mentioned to you that these are not pathogenic organisms. So there is no problem with their disposal. Actually, we isolate them from the natural sites. They are not like the E. coli or something which is going to affect your human system. They are non-pathogenic organisms. Recovery of metals from slag. Yes, a lot of work has been done on, just like I talked about tailings, there is a lot of work for slag also, that is processed slags. And all you have to do is like a leaching process. So we have, I mean, I have not done it myself, but I was the examiner for a student's thesis in Sweden, where they were trying to recover the steel making LD slag. They were looking at chromium, nickel, those metals, recovery from those slags. So that was, it is possible.
Leaching of iron, what is it used for?
You mean
bio-leaching of iron?
Okay. See, in the context of non-ferrous extractive metallurgy, iron is actually a penalty for your non-ferrous operations, for smelter, etc. So when you talk of recovering copper or lead or zinc, that has more value in a sulfide deposit compared to iron. So, why you have to remove the iron is something to do with the impurity removal. So people, if you are having iron as an impurity and you want to remove it, then that can be used as a, this can be used because pyrite is an impurity. So you can leach the pyrite. So that commercially it has, you know, iron being available as the oxide in a much larger form, as you know, for iron making operations we use hematite, magnetite, etc. We don't use the pyrite. But there is a lot of interest today that conservation of these materials, people are trying to recover the iron from the red mud, not only by leaching, but also smelting process. So you will be surprised that they want to use the red mud as a source of iron, because it contains more than 40-50% of iron. So the secondary resources of the oxides, which are is also being taught about now. So iron removal in non-ferrous is mostly for impurity removal. The participants again for lively discussion. Of course, they were my teachers also, Professor Sudhakar Naik, Professor Hebbar, Institute of Research for Development. From France. So I thank all of them for actually coming to this lecture, and in a sense coming to Suratkal has always been a sort of a homecoming for me. I have very nostalgic memories of this place, particularly in the formative years of my professional life. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. There's an announcement. After this event, at 4 p.m., the same venue, we have a talk by Professor Rahul Mitra, Department of Metallurgy, IIT Kharagpur, on structure property relations in composite materials designed for high temperature applications. Moving on to the last part of this event, we have Ms. Munali Sona to extend the word of thanks.
It's a privilege and great joy for me to extend a word of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering, extend a very hearty thanks to Honorable Chief Guest Professor S. Subramanian for gracing today's lecture series. Thank you, sir, for your very informative talk and sharing with us your findings and opinions today. We are also grateful to Founder Head of our Department, Professor T. Ramachandran, for addressing the gathering. Thank you, sir, for your presence and insights. We need your grace every year, sir. We express our sincere thanks to Professor Uday Kumar Yaragatti, Director in Charge NITK, for his presidential address. Thank you, sir. I wish to acknowledge the support and encouragement rendered by our Director, Professor Swapan Bhattacharya, to conduct this lecture series. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for all the sponsors who have contributed to Professor D. Ramachandran Lecture Fund. Their contribution has made the lecture series self-sustaining and successful one. We also would like to acknowledge our gratitude to all the invitees and guests for accepting our invitation and being with us today. I wish to express my gratitude to Mrs. Jayalakshmi for leading us in prayer and Mr. Sudhir for being the master of ceremony. I extend my thanks to Watch and Ward for their kind help and support, and all those who have contributed in one way or the other to make this lecture series a successful one. I thank each one of you for your presence here this afternoon. Without you, this event would not have been possible. Thank you very much.
With this, we have come to the end of this event. Thank you all.